think is, let me see this. Authorities. So it looks almost exactly like Taylor Brennan. Taylor Brennan would be something like this. T is 3 raised to the power raised to point A, multiplied by x minus A raised to power k, divided by k factorial. Taylor Brennan would start from 0 and end at n. So we'll take n pairs. For Taylor series, we won't stop. We'll just continue summing up the terms all the way up to this, up to infinity. So this is a power series. We know that Taylor polynomials are good approximations for the function f. They're not quite that, but the difference between the function and the polynomial, well, is pretty small. For this series, the partial sums, the sums from 0 to n, are exactly the Taylor polynomials. So if you take the sum not to infinity but only to n, you'll get the degree n Taylor polynomial. And Taylor polynomials, we know, they approximate our function better and better. The greater n is, the larger n is, the closer the function is to the actual polynomial. So if these remainder terms keep getting smaller and smaller with n, then this series isn't actually equal to this function. So for here I should say reasonable functions, I'll explain in a second what reasonable means. This series isn't just equal to the function itself. Well, of course, not always. Whenever it converges. If the series diverges, then nothing can be done about it. So whenever the series converges. And when I say reasonable functions, well, basically, we have a criterion for when the Taylor series is actually equal to the functions, when the remainders keep getting smaller and smaller with n. But, well, cheat a little bit. I'll just say that for functions which can be written very formally. So all the functions which are elementary functions, like functions with involve sines, cosines, tangents, logarithms, exponentials, powers, summations, products, quotients. You can take derivatives, you can take integrals of those functions. So all such functions, all the reasonable operations, get into functions for which this equality is true. So for more or less, let me also give some functions which doesn't work. So functions which are not continuous, don't have all the derivatives, basically you cannot form such a power series. For this power series, you need a function to have infinite main derivatives. For example, a function like epsilon and s wouldn't have any Taylor series around the quality. But for most reasonable functions, such a quality will hold. And it's a very rich source of power series which can be computed, and vice versa. If you have a function which is somewhat complicated, sometimes you can write it as a power series which is actually easier to manipulate. We'll see both cases. So let's talk about examples. So first example is a function e to the power x. Oh yes, one word. The Taylor series is Ongoing series for e to the power x. It's already one of the simplest ones in Python. So if my function is e to the power x, I'll tend to find the derivatives of all order at the point 0. That's quite easy. The derivative of e to x is e to x. Second derivative, still e to x. In fact, the derivative of any order is e to x. So, the derivative at the point 0 is e to the power 0, which is 1. So, the ongoing series for e to the power x and the series around 0 is such a sum. Sum from k to 0 to infinity of 1, the value of derivative at point 0, times x minus 0 to the power k, divided by k factor. Or in other words, 1 plus x plus x over 1 factorial, x over 2 factorial, x over 3 factorial. This point holds for any x. We can plug in whatever number x you want. Still, you can avoid it. So, for instance, for example, let's say you did not know what e is. You did not know what e is 2.71728, and so on and so on. So, suppose you wanted to find it. We'll just plug in x equals find what is in as many digits as you want. So 1 over 5 factorial is always 1 over 120. So this means you need 3 digits. 1 over 10 factorial is already pretty large. Some like 1 million, so you want 9 digits. Some 10 terms like this, and so on. Basically, the ratio is Other questions? Okay, so cosine. Once you know the power series for sine, the power series for cosine can be found quite easy. Just differentiate the previous one. Cosine is the unit of sine. This is 1, this is square root of 2 factorial, this is the cos of 4 factorial, minus x to the sine of 6 factorial, and so on. Or in sigma notation, some even powers. Thank you. in accordance with any law. But we include him in the future part. One was expelled, but there's something that one was expelled, this one was placed, was expelled, this. But still, who knows? Okay, so you see that it is important. Oh, I think. So, well, I wouldn't try the power series notation for this. It's very complicated. The better definition is much more complicated than any of those. But basically, for most of the functions, we can write the power series extension around zero. So that's what I did. You should be able to recognize all these power series. Given such power series, or power series which looks like it, you should be able to do some algebraic calculation and find the most for it. So basically, it's a good idea, first of all, to remember this power series, and second thing, by writing integration, solve a couple of exercises. Of the form, here's the power series, find the closed form. Do some exercises. Here's a car. thing can be explained in Taylor series. How? Well, 1 over square root of 2pi. I know the Taylor series expansion for a to power x over there. 1 plus x over 1 factorial plus x squared over 2 factorial plus q over 3 factorial and so on. So I write it, but instead of x, I'll keep minus x squared over 2. So it's 1 plus minus x squared over 2 over 1 factorial plus minus x squared over 2 squared over 2 factorial and so on. So I get a power series expansion. 1 over square root of 2pi times 1 minus x squared divided by 2 plus x squared over 2 squared times q factorial minus x cubed over 2 cubed times 3 factorial. And so on. So sorry, it's x squared, x to the fourth, x to the sixth, x to the eighth. So it's x squared raised to consecutive powers. And, okay. So because I know a power series expansion for e to the power x, I also know the power series expansion for e to the power minus x squared by 2. Just plug in instead of x, minus x squared by 2. So here I have an occurring series expansion for f prime of x. Well, there isn't anything simpler than to integrate the power series. Just do it term by term. If I want to find f itself, just integrate. After a constant, I found a series expansion for my function. Now, if I want to find this function, I can just plug in s. So if I want to find the value of this function at some point in 1, I just plug in 1 in this formula and I find the value of function. Except this constant. So this constant is still there. I know my function after the constant. Well, there is a point where I do know the value of this function. So if you recall, now it's about vector probability a little bit. The density function looks like this. It's a Gaussian well. It has a data point 0, and it is symmetric around the point 0. Density function looks like this. The probability that the variable is at most 0, this area, is exactly on top of the overall area, which is 1. So f of 0 isn't that long enough. The probability that the normal instability variable in v0 is less than 0 is 1 half. It's equally likely to be less than 0 as it is to be greater than 0. So, if I plug this information into this formula, when x is 0, this thing is 0, what is the probability that your variable is more than 1? Well, plug in 1. 1 cup plus 1 plus the root of y plus 1 minus 1 plus 3 minus 2 plus 1 plus 5 plus the root of factorial minus and so on and so on. If you want to make it to find this with any precision, just compute the numbers. So even though this function doesn't have an elementary integral, it does have an integral which is some power series. And power series is often, well, just as good as a formula, sometimes better. Sometimes power series is actually easier to work with than actual formula. So this thing doesn't have a simple formula, it does have a simple enough power series. And that was the actually the great discovery of Newton. Not only he discovered this Taylor series, which once again one can argue that it's not even human since our own. What Newton did realize is that this power series can be used for solving differential equations, for integration, for doing lots and lots of interesting things. Okay, so questions about this application. This application, it's not for the example, because it is important enough to give it some time here. Questions? Yeah.
With 0 equals 1/2, are you just calculating the area under
the curve? Yeah, so this step comes from our knowledge about the vector f of x is basically a cumulative distribution function for normally a distributed random variable, and the distribution, the density function is symmetric around 0. So whatever the area to the left of 0 is, it is equal to the area to the right. And overall, the area is equal to 1. So which one depends on that? Other questions? Okay, so let's discuss other type of exercises. Here's a somewhat surprising one. Compute the limit as equal to 0 of cosine of x minus square root of 1 plus 1 plus x squared divided by sine of x. So 1 minus this. So this question looks like it is not about power series at all. It looks like a question basically about the Pitagorean. You have a numerator which as x goes to 0 approaches the sign of 0 minus 1, which is 0, square is equal to 0, denominator approaches 0, so quotient of 0 divided by 0, we should apply the Pitagorean. Okay, maybe it is a good idea. But if you do apply the Pitagorean rule, you find that you once again get an expression of the form 0 divided by 0. And you have to apply the Pitagorean rule once again. The problem is, in this particular exercise, you'll have to apply the Pitagorean rule 8 consecutive times until you get to the answer. 8 times. So you should imagine that you'll have to find 8 derivatives of this complicated function, or that complicated. It's actually quite complicated, and the chance that you'll make a mistake along the way is close to 1. Instead, we can failure series of this function, of this function. So when I want to talk about what the proportion is when x is small, so I know that when x is small, cosine of x, first of all, it's approximately 1. I can do better. Cosine of x is in fact 1 minus x squared divided by 2. So not 5. Plus x to the fourth divided by 4 factorial. Minus and so on. So I have a Taylor series extension around the point 0, which tells you from the first approximation, cosine is 1. If you want to be a little bit more precise, it's 1 minus x squared divided by 2. If you want to be even more precise, 1 minus x squared over 2 factorial plus x to the fourth over 4 factorial. And so on. So the more summons you have, the more corrections you have. The next is small, maybe 0.01. The higher terms basically contain only the first couple of terms. So x squared is, if x is 0.1, x squared is 0.01. x to the fourth is 0.0001. So this term is much smaller than that one. Similarly about the other things, square root of 1 minus x squared. What is it equal to when x is small? No, I will use this extension. Square root of 1 plus something is 1 plus 1 half of this something. So it's 1 plus 1 half times minus x squared plus 1 half times 1 half minus 1 divided by 2 factorial times minus x squared squared and so on. So I'm using this power series except this, well, alpha is equal to 1 half. Instead of x I write minus x squared. Because here I have square root of 1 minus x squared. So I see that square root of 1 minus x squared is approximately 1. If I want to be more precise, it's 1 minus x squared divided by 2. If I want to be even more precise, it's 1 minus x squared by 2. So what is it here? 1 half times minus 1 half divided by 2 is 1 over 8. So I believe it's minus 1 over 8. And then corrections of new higher order. So what can I say about the difference? Cosine of x minus square root of 1 minus x squared. Take the difference. This minus this is, so 1 minus 1 is 0, minus x squared by 2. Also gets cancelled out. These terms are already not equal to each other. So it's x to the fourth over 3 to 4 minus x to the fourth over 8. So minus x to the fourth over 8 plus higher order terms. So something is x to the 6, 8, and so on. So it is approximately that, and the square of this is approximately the square of this. So it's 1 over 36, f to the power 8, plus some corrections. At this point, I don't keep track of the corrections. I just want to understand how it behaves to the very first approximation. So here I did want to keep track of a couple of terms, because I didn't keep track of the fourth powers. I would just know the sine of x minus the square root is approximately 0. It doesn't tell you how it behaves. But if I do keep track of all the powers up to the fourth, I'll have a much more precise information. The difference is approximately x to the fourth over 6, so square root of the difference is approximately x to the 8 over 36. First approximation is quotient.